अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, दिस इज़ योर स्पेशल पैथोलॉजी प्रैक्टिकल एंड टुडे विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद सर्वाइकल कार्सिनोमा। सर्वाइकल कार्सिनोमा इज द मलिग्नेंट न्यूप्लाज्म विच अराइजेज फ्रॉम द सेल्स ऑफ द सर्विक्स। इट इज़ द सेकेंड मोस्ट कॉमन कैंसर अमंग वेमेन एंड थर्ड मोस्ट कॉमन कॉज ऑफ डेथ अमंग वेमेन। मेजॉरिटी ऑफ द केसेज आर फ्रॉम डिवेलपिंग कंट्रीज ड्यू टू high occurrence of HPV infection. Pakistan has about 20 cases per 100,000 population. Talking about the anatomy of cervix, cervix as you all know is the lowest part of the uterus. It is about 1 inch in length. It has two types of epithelia. One is stratified squamous epithelium which forms the exocervix, and then is simple columnar epithelium which forms the endocervix. And in between there is a transitional zone where the two epithelia are interchanging. This is called squamocolumnar junction. There are multiple risk factors which can contribute to the development of cervical carcinoma. HPV infection is the most important risk factors all around the world. And as in any other cancer, family history or age also play an important role. Smoking and HIV infection or immunocompromised state, they are also very important risk factors for cervical carcinoma. Now you must have done cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, so quickly we'll go through this. Cervical intraepithelial neoplasia is graded into three grades, starting depending upon the involvement of thickness of the cervix. So when there is full thickness of the cervix which is involved, which has dysplasia, and this is we label it as cervical intraepithelial neoplasia 3. The cervical carcinoma has different subtypes. The most common subtype is squamous cell carcinoma, which has about 80% of the cases, and then adenocarcinoma, which is 15% of the cases. Now in this picture, you can see normal epithelium, normal cervix, then different grades of cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, which progressively change ultimately into invasive cancer. This invasive cancer or cervical carcinoma, as you can see, is going beyond the basement membrane and it has involved the surrounding tissues as well. Now the next topic is endometrial hyperplasia. Endometrial hyperplasia is defined as an increased proliferation of endometrial glands relative to the stroma, which results in an increased gland to stroma ratio when compared with normal proliferative endometrium. There are multiple risk factors involved in the development of endometrial hyperplasia: estrogen replacement therapy, polycystic ovary syndrome, estrogen producing tumors, and obesity and diabetes mellitus. So all these states you can classify them as they are the consequence of unopposed estrogen. There are various types of endometrial hyperplasia: simple hyperplasia, complex hyperplasia without ATPM, and then complex atypical hyperplasia. Now in this picture you can see simple hyperplasia of the endometrium. Now here you can see multiple enlarged glands, and the stroma has become compact, and you can also see the spindle cells of the endometrium. Now here is another figure. It is not colored, not histologically stained, but still clear enough to make you understand. In the figure A there you can see simple hyperplasia. In simple hyperplasia the endometrium contains increased number of glands, embedded in the stroma. It has a typical name, Swiss cheese pattern. And then in the figure B, you can see complex hyperplasia without atypia. The endometrium contains an increased number of irregularly shaped glands as compared to the simple hyperplasia where the glands are regularly in shape, while in figure B you can clearly see that the glands are irregularly shaped. And also it is different from complex atypical hyperplasia because there is glandular atypia but there is no cellular atypia. In complex hyperplasia with atypia, there will be both glandular atypia as well as cellular atypia. That will be all for today. Thank you very much.